Please rise. our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
I make wheel and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to read Psalm 96. We're going to do this independently. Ask the side that I'm on to sing, to speak, the light-colored print. And we'll ask the band side of the church to do the filled print. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Proclaim God's salvation from day to day.
Declare God's glory among the nations and God's wonders among all peoples.
For praise the Lord, greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols, but you, O Lord, have made the heavens.
Majesty and magnificence are in your presence. Power and splendor are in your sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor due the holy name. Bring offerings and enter the courts of the Lord.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before the Lord, all the earth.
Tell it out among the nations. The Lord is King, the one who made the world so firm that it cannot be moved. Will judge the peoples with equity.
Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder, and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful, and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy at your coming, O Lord, for you come to judge the earth.
You will judge the world with righteousness, and the peoples with truth. The second reading is from the first chapter of Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. Just as you know what kind of persons we prove to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only to Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known. So that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite the children up for a message. Chair? You don't have any special blankets? Or get stuffed animals? Or books? Do you? Okay. You'd like it? Okay. And toys? Okay. They belong to you, don't they? Okay. So now think, what do you belongs to you? A life? Okay, that's good too. All right, what? Your choice to what belongs? Now think about your house and what belongs to mom and dad. What belongs to mom and dad? The who? The sauna?
Sauna.
Okay. All right, what else? What? Us. You guys belong to mom and dad. Very good. Okay. And how about the car? Or the TV? The car belongs to mom. Yes, I said they belong to mom and dad. Okay. All right. So all those things. A van. Okay. Those belong to mom and dad too, don't they? Okay. All that stuff belongs to mom and dad, right? Okay. That's right. So all those things belong to moms and dads, right? Okay. So what? Another question. What belongs to God?
Us.
Right. You and moms and dads and everybody out there, right? And what else belongs to God besides us? The world. And what else?
His house.
Okay. What else?
Everything.
Right, Charlie? What else? Everything belongs to God, right? You were saying that. Good. So everything belongs to God. So does that mean that your special blankets and your toys and mom's and dad's cars, those all belong to God? That's right. They all belong to God. What?
Stones?
Yep. Everything belongs to God, right? So what are we supposed to do with it? What are we supposed to do with it? We take good care of it, don't we? Right?
We take care of it.
We don't punch it. No, we don't. So we take good care of it because we take care of it for God. And what does God want us to do with it? Does God want us to waste it?
No.
Does God want us to keep it?
Yes.
Do you want us to keep it?
No.
What does he want us to do with it?
Shh.
What do we do with it? Starts with a shh. He wants us to shh. Share it, right?
Yeah.
What was our word today that God wants us to do? To give. To give, right? So we learned about forgiveness, right? And encouragement, right? And all of that is from our actions, right? And we give from our heart because everything we have is God's and we give it back to God, don't we? So that we take care of everybody else, right? Can we do that? Okay, yes, you got that, Sunday school. Right? Is that to share? It's to remind you about God, right? Who's on that? Whose face is on there? Is that Abraham Lincoln or somebody? Yeah? Okay. Pretend it's you. Pretend that's your face. And when you listen to the sermon, pretend that that's your face on that point. Okay? All right. So you listen, and we'll pretend that our face is on that point. We do that. So this week you go and act like Jesus and be givers. We will. Good job. Okay. All right. Go act like Jesus. Thank you. As you're coming to your feet, guys, join the gospel acclamation.
Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Well, it had to happen sometime, one of these days. Finally, the Pharisees got it right. They have Jesus right where they want him, caught between the proverbial rock and hard place. Pay the tax or not. If Jesus answers positively that they should pay the tax to Rome, the crowd who has been following him would likely turn on him and no longer look upon him with favor. If he answers negatively, the crowd will continue to love him, but that stance would make it appear that he is against the Roman government, and that would not be a good thing. But not so fast, my friend. Jesus is not to be trapped. Instead of answering the question, he poses a question of his own. After obtaining a coin of the empire from his accusers, the coin that would be used to pay the tax, Jesus asks whose image is on it. The answer, the emperor's. "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." Give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. This text seems to write itself for stewardship, doesn't it? Give to God the things that are God's. What else is there to say? Everything we have and are is God's. So I guess we better just give it all to God and be done with it. Amen. If only it were that simple. The widow in our story 2 weeks ago lived out this directive. She gave all she had, her two coins, and more. She gave her very self to God. She knew what belonged to God. She knew it was God who gave her life. And it is God who gives us life. But wait, not so fast. Let's add one more thing to the puzzle. Let's add Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. No, it's not part of today's lessons, but maybe it should be. Genesis 1:26 reads, "Then God said, 'Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth.'" Let us make humankind in our own image, according to our likeness. Likeness. Likeness in Genesis, and it's the word used in Matthew. So we could read Jesus' question as, "Whose likeness is this, and what title?" Whose likeness is on the coin? Rather than accusing his opponents of blasphemy or disloyalty, Jesus calls them hypocrites, those who have literally taken to wearing another and false likeness. Another way to think about it could be as if they have amnesia. They have forgotten who they are, in whose likeness they were made. They have forgotten their primary identity as God's children and stewards, as those made in the likeness of God, and charged to act like the God we see in Jesus. But what about you and me? We were made in the image and likeness of God too. So what does our identity as God's children mean for us? It means that because we bear God's likeness, we are to act like God, not like gods, those who lord their authority over others for self-gain, but rather like God, the one who creates and sustains and nourishes and nurtures and redeems and saves, no matter what the cost. We are called to serve as God's agents, God's partners, and God's co-workers, exercising dominion over creation, not as an act of power, but rather as an act of stewardship, and extending to all the abundant life God wants for all. The Sunday school children are learning about faith practices, practicing our faith, and how we can be like Jesus. The key words they've been talking about so far are forgiveness, generosity, action, rejection, and more specifically, how we don't reject others, and encouragement. Today we added giving. Our prayer each week ends with the phrase, "I want to act like Jesus." That's tough to do, act like Jesus. It's hard figuring out just what that means for our daily life, decisions, and actions. But what are the children doing? They are learning, and they are practicing, learning to be disciples, learning to be faithful, learning what it means to be in the image of God. How? By doing. That leads me to a challenge to you. The ushers are going to help me out a bit. After getting a crossbar for the cross 3 weeks ago, 2 pennies 2 weeks ago, and a Bible passage last week, this week you get a treat. Literally, a treat. You get a piece of candy, like the stuff you'll be giving out or getting on Halloween. Remember, I said a treat. And the whatever was going to, what was it going to that now I'm back to being empty, looking and searching for something, anything, that would restore life. Now look at that candy for a moment. Look at it. And think of all those things that claim to be life givers. At best, they can give you a momentary At worst, think of your teeth and your waistline. So maybe instead, we need to check out our likeness, not in the mirror, but gazing instead at the cross. Look at the likeness and see whose we are. Remember, we bear the likeness of God, the one who creates and sustains and nurtures and redeems and saves, no matter what the cost. And bearing the likeness of God, we are called to serve as God's agents, God's partners, and God's co-workers, exercising dominion over creation, not as an act of power, but rather as an act of stewardship, and extending to all the abundant life God wants for all. And bearing the likeness of God, we are to give ourselves to God, our whole selves, our entire being, because as Jesus says, that which bears God's likeness belongs to God. And that which belongs to God is held in the embrace of the crucified Christ, held in the life and hope that comes from the gift of the crucified Jesus. That is the core of our stewardship. Bearing the likeness of God, we are embraced by the crucified Christ and gifted with real life, not just a momentary, but the reward of life that cannot be lost. And that allows us to let go of our obsession with the things of life that just don't cut it, the things that claim life, but deliver emptiness. And that is what empowers us to be generous with what we have, not clinging to our things and our wealth, as if somehow there we will have life. Instead, the freedom to let go, even as we are embraced by the crucified Jesus. So take your candy home and ponder your ahs. All those quick, temporary, fleeting ahs. Then, find a cross in your home, somewhere, anywhere, and if you can't find one, draw one quickly and simply on a piece of paper. And in the cross, see your likeness. See how you are in the likeness of God's presence through Jesus. See how you belong to God through the embrace of the crucified one. And then sit back and say, for this ah is going nowhere. This is the ah of life, of abundant life, of life that can never be taken away. Amen. As you are comfortable, I invite you to rise and join in the singing of Give Thanks, which is found in your bulletin. Thank you.
invite the rest of you to be seated. God, who is, I'm sorry, we're on page 227, excuse me, page 227 in the front of your hymnal, if you want to pop it out, please. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. Called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, I ask parents, do you desire to have your child baptized into Christ? As you bring Wilson to receive the gift of baptism, you were entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. Place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture him in faith and prayer, so that Wilson may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help Wilson grow in the Christian faith and life? Sponsors, do you promise to nurture Wilson in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit and to help him live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church? People of God, do you promise to support Wilson and pray for him in his new life in Christ?
We do.
As you are comfortable, would you please rise? I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family, and through the seas you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death and raise us up to live in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Congregation, please be seated. Wilson Wallace, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Wilson Wallace with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Wilson Wallace, child of God, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever.
This larger candle here is called a Paschal candle. We light this candle on three occasions. We light it during the season of Easter, we light it at baptisms, and we light it again at funerals. We light it during the season of Easter to remind us that it is the death and resurrection of Jesus that brings forth the possibility, the hope, the promise of new life. We light it in baptism to remind us that in the waters of baptism, that promise is given to the child or the adult who is baptized. Today it is given to Wilson, as God promises that the death of Jesus is sufficient for him. We light it at funerals to remind us that God does not forget promise that he made, and that when the life in this world comes to an end, God welcomes us into new life. We take a baptism candle and light it from the Paschal candle to remind us that as we journey through life, the darkness that we sometimes encounter in life is shed aside by the light of the promises that God has made in baptism in through the crucified Jesus. So I'm going to give this candle. Who's safe with fire? Is Dad, are you safe with fire from one of us? We're going to give you that candle with the invitation that each year on this date, you light that candle for a few minutes to remind Wilson that God is with him. And even in the darkest of days, the light of Christ shines brightly. Let us welcome the newly baptized. We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. We have some gifts, and I'm not sure who has them. Someone has them. Oh, here they are.
We've got a quilt, and we have a Bible. This is our first Bible. We have a new program that we're doing for our 0 to 3-year-olds. We talked about that. This is a gift. Memorial gift for you, that now you have your first Bible to look at. Look at all the pictures and stuff in there, all just for you to read with Mom and Dad. And we have special things to do with our frolic program and stuff that you can do, you and Mom together, you and Mom and Dad. Yeah, so there's a special Bible for you. You guys hold it, because there's something else special too.
We also have a blanket, one made by one of our members that we gift to our children. I'm going to have the blanket. I'm going to see if Wilson, you come with me for a minute. I'll bring it back, I promise. Maybe Mom could come with us. Come on, Mom will come with us, okay? Mom's going to come along. This is your new family. These are the people of God who care for you and love you, and they're going to pray for you, and they're going to come over and they're going to give you a little blessing. It's okay. I don't care the big day, but splash of water, you get oil put on you, and in front of everybody, and the band's playing, and all these strange people, and then you got the pastors. So they're going to give you a blessing because this is your new family. These are people who love you and care for you, and they're going to remember you in their prayers. Okay? You in their prayers as you grow older. And some of these people you know you'll get to know, Some of them you may never know, but it doesn't matter. We are all part of the same body of Christ, the same people of God. We're all brothers and sisters together. Yes, will you ever give him a blessing? Very good. Oops, wait. We have him. He was eating. There. Okay, thanks. So now you can put the candle out, and you can return to your seats. And Wilson, thank you for being a part of this community and being a child of God with us. Yeah. That's okay, huh? Comfortable, would you please rise and would you join in prayer? Open to the gifts of the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation.
Trusting in God, we pray for the church. Fill all worshipers with your Holy Spirit. Grant them generous hearts to share God's splendor, revealed to them in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Children, for young lives, pray for them and hold them in your tender care. Lord, in your mercy. give us these gifts of the earth, these resources of our life and our labor. Take them, offered in great thanksgiving, and use them to set a table that will heal the whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior and light.
Amen.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. As we receive the sacrament this morning, please note that we have gluten-free wafers as well as standard wafers. We also have grape juice along with the wine. If you have need of those items, please indicate that to us as you come forward. For those of you who are visitors with us, please note the communion invitation in the bulletin. We do sincerely invite you to join with us. Speak to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, and make us one with you. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Holy and compassionate God, in bread and wine you give us gifts that form us to be humble and courageous. May your words come to life in our serving and in our witness, that we might speak a living voice of healing and justice to all the world, through Jesus Christ, our Rock and our Redeemer.
Amen.
I ask Linda to come forward as she will be visiting Homebound Christmas this week. Eternal God, whose glory is revealed in the crucified and risen Lord, bless those who go forth to share your word and sacrament with our sisters and brothers who are homebound. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those to whom we bring this communion in the body and blood of your Son, that we may all feast upon your abundant love made known in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, creator of all things, speaking reformation into being, Jesus Christ, Savior of the world, raising the dead, Holy Spirit, living voice, calling and enlightening the church, Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the announcements. A couple things. I'm going to ask Amani to come up first. While she's coming up, I'm just going to say very quickly, there are things in the bulletin about the ELCA Youth Gathering. The deadline is fast approaching. Please make note of that. Eighth graders through seniors, current seniors, are up for that. And OWLS, please remember, the OWLS outing this week looks really good. Bonnie has something to say about Norwegian dinner.
I just wanted to fill you in. Our Norwegian dinner is in 2 weeks from yesterday. So I was reviewing our sign-up sheets, and we have a lot of open spaces, especially on the second shift, which generally runs from about 5:30 to 6 o'clock through about 8:30. And we can't do our dinner without the help of all of you, and we've had a lot of success. It's a great time if you've never worked at it. I strongly suggest that you sign up and try it. We'll pair you with somebody that's done the job already, so we won't throw you out there and make you sink or swim. So don't worry about that. We'll find you just the right job at a time that works for you. We are in need of, at first shift, we still need some table waiters, and there's some other jobs, but that's a kind of a large opening. And at second shift, we have table waiters, cooking potatoes, cooking the fish, melting butter, dishwashers, busing. There's all kinds of jobs at second shift. And we don't want our guests, last year we served an extra 100 people, so we don't want our late guests to have nobody to wait on them either. So if you could stop by the table, we'll help you find a job. We also, if you like to bring something, cranberries, we are still in need of cranberries, Norwegian baking. So if you've ever wanted to try it, or you do have done it in the past, I strongly suggest just try it and see how it goes. We also need other baking, and then we still need one person to donate a 50-pound bag of potatoes. So anyway, I hope to talk to all of you. Inger and I will be at the table out back. So please join us. It's a lot of fun.
Two things need to be mentioned about the dinner. First of all, Bonnie Goodenough, Inger Michael, and Lynette Ender put in hours and hours and hours of planning it. So, we need all of us to work, but they have already done a whole lot of work. But here's the other thing that's really important about it. Please remember, all the proceeds from the dinner go to mission work outside of the congregation. We don't keep that to ourselves. So if you're thinking, put some time into it, think of it as a mission outreach. It goes to all sorts of organizations in our community that meet needs locally and even globally. So it's really a mission outreach form, and so think about that as you think about being able to be a part of the work. And it's a lot of fun too. It's really a lot of fun, so please join us for that. Two other things, very, very briefly, as I have my notes. Wednesday morning Bible study is focusing on prayer for the next few weeks. So if you want to kind of dig a little deeper into prayer and think a little bit about prayer in terms of what it is, and how it can be for you, please join us Wednesday morning for a Bible study. And then the last thing, as promised last week, we're going to start a new item in the bulletin each week called a breath prayer. And what a breath prayer is a very, very short prayer, usually a scripture passage, that you can say in one breath. It's why it's called the breath prayer. And so the breath prayer this morning, it's in the bulletin, is, O Lord, have compassion on your servants. And the idea is that you kind of commit that to memory. Take it home, stick it on the refrigerator, kind of into some kind of thing you can burn into your short-term memory. And so this week, if you're out driving around, you get to the stoplight, we're only going to wait for the stoplight to change. O Lord, have compassion on your servants. You know, it's something you can say quickly. You're at the grocery store, you're standing in line, you're having a cup of coffee, break time at work, wherever. Just, O Lord, have compassion on your servants. Becomes a brief, just a real brief, quick prayer called the breath prayer. And there'll be another one, a different one in next week in the bulletin. So please watch that bulletin each week, the breath prayer that you can use. Anything else? Oh, coffee fellowship. We're looking in for some people to be a part of hospitality ministry and signing up for coffee fellowship. I'm not sure if we got anybody for next week, but next week is Reformation Sunday. So if we didn't get anybody, check it out. Please sign up for that. Next Sunday, wear red. It is Reformation Sunday. We'll have lots of music, lots of fun music. Thanks, by the way, to the band for the music this week. But next week we'll have music. Join us. Wear red, the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. If you miss it next week, you're going to wait 500 years. So don't do that. Be with us next week and wear red and celebrate the Reformation, the 500th anniversary. Our worship concludes with hymn number 705. As you're comfortable, would you please rise?
Thank you. Thank you.